So in the breaking of bread, therefore, now we want to look at the application. We demonstrate, number one, the Lord's compassion for the needy by sharing our meals with others. So breaking of bread is not only about Holy Communion. It's also what we do when we share our meals with other people. When I was growing up, I spent some time in a Muslim part of Lagos. And there was one thing they used to call Sahara. I don't know if they still do it. The fellow would cook a big meal and would be sharing it throughout the streets. And people would take it and eat. Nobody was afraid that there was juju in the food. The man was happy. Maybe he was celebrating something. Maybe he got a promotion. You would cook. And then they would take the food. They would carry it. You see food moving from house to house. And once they move like that, all every one of us will rush into the house because, man, we are blowing Sahara. In Jude chapter, verse 12, Jude is one chapter. Jude chapter 1, verse 12. The A part of it is speaking about people who come to destruction, but there's a point I want to raise. It says, these are sports in your love feasts. While they feast with you without fear, serving only themselves. What is he referring to here? In those days, they had love feasts. Do you understand? It was a love feast where what I just described to you as Sarah now was a love feast. So in Acts chapter 2, when the Bible says they were breaking bread from house to house, they were having love feasts. It's like today I want to have a feast. For lunch, let's all gather together, let's have lunch together. We all gather together, we eat. As my house can accommodate, it won't be everybody. There were 3,120, and more people were being added anyway. So it would just be small groups that would meet, and they would meet together and share the same meal. They shared together the same meal, eating the same meal, and therefore, like we said earlier, declaring loyalty to one another. You see, this is another form of bonding and sharing. That's what I said. You cannot truly have fellowship if sharing of meals is not involved. There's so much plasticness, I can use that expression, in the Church of God today. We gather together in church, but we don't know ourselves. Remember when we're starting in the early times, we used to go from house to house, especially the ministry team. We went from one house to the other every other Sunday or thereabout. And we shared meals. We got to know ourselves better. We got to know where people live. It didn't matter where they lived. We just got together and we shared meals together. So it is a way of expressing the Lord's compassion to the needy. We may not do it in the church, but like I said, told you, you could have meals and share with your neighbors. It's not because you are doing it, you just want to share your meal. Why? You remember how the Lord provided for the 5,000 and for the 4,000. From the little he had, he didn't have much. But as he broke it, God began to multiply the little that was in his hands and fed so many. We need to begin to do those things. Not because we want a miracle of abundance, but because we want to be able to feed other people, even from the little that we have. When we share the little that we have, we are able to be filled. But there's so much withholding. We're doing a study on Proverbs the other day, and we read, I think it's Proverbs 12, 24 to 26, says, there is that scattereth, and yet he increaseth. And there is that withholdeth more than is necessary, and he tendeth to poverty. There is the need for us to scatter, even the little that we have. And the Bible says that you will increase. You will increase. We are not seeing many of these miracles because we don't do these things. So there were the love feasts that he had. And as a result, people gathered. And what Jude was saying is that these false prophets, they come in for those love feasts. They have become a sport, spoiling the feast with their ways and other things. I think Peter also referred to them in 2 Peter. Secondly, we are talking about when we break bread, we are demonstrating the Lord's suffering and death for our sins. And therefore, our own willingness to do do the same for other brethren. That even as the Lord paid the price for our sins, we also are willing to pay the price that is necessary for our fellow brothers. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 26 to 34 to the end, it says, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup," it's talking of the Lord's Supper now, "you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord." We're going to discuss this when we're looking at the implication. "But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, and not discerning the Lord's body. For this reason, many are weak and sick among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened by the Lord, that we may not be condemned with the world." What is he saying here? When we eat with malice in our heart towards our fellow brother, we are eating unworthily. Do you understand? Not discerning the Lord's body. Because the Lord came and died for everybody. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on him should not perish but have everlasting life. Bible says, "While we are yet sinners, Christ died for the ungodly." Then we have been so forgiven with such great grace, we now come together to eat with malice in our hearts, with wickedness and evil thoughts in our hearts. And we expect that God will hear us. Verse 33, "Therefore, my brethren, when you come together to eat, wait for one another. But if anyone is hungry, let him eat at home, lest you come together for judgment. And the rest I will set in order when I come." What is he saying there? Look, I think it's explained later. In those days, Holy Communion was not really what we call it today, where we have one service. Holy Communion was something that took place after they had eaten. It was like the dessert. After they had eaten and they had food, somebody would now bring bread and say, "We remember on the night that the Lord was betrayed, took bread and broke it, and then they would share it to everyone." You know what it did to them? It sobered them down. It not allowed them to just go wild after the eating. They were sober. They were calm. But it was as a result of the feasting. They would have feasted and eaten, you know, enjoyed themselves together, bonded, shared one with one another. Then towards the end, somebody will now bring bread and break it and begin to share. And as they're sharing, he's telling the story. Usually it will be one of the apostles or one of the elders in that gathering who will now do that. Now, Jude was referring to some of those so-called elders who would come, and instead of discussing the death of the Lord by the sharing of the bread, what are they discussing? They are discussing money. They are discussing how they can be made rich by the people that they are sharing to. "See, as I'm sharing this bread to you, make sure that you're also sharing of your substance with me." Was that the essence? No. So they became sports in their love feasts. And after they had eaten the bread, they would now give them wine and share the wine also. And it's as though they are pledging an allegiance to one another and to God. Remember, we said fellowship. When we talk of fellowship, bond and sharing, we have a fellowship one with another and also with the Godhead. In the same way here, our eating, our sharing of meals is not just amongst ourselves, but also the Lord himself is present at such meals. We recognize that he's there as we are breaking bread. The breaking of bread brings close to our hearts the understanding that Christ is present. Not in the meal. Do you understand? Which is what some people decide. They said, he is present in the breaking of bread. He is present in our midst. It brings that understanding to us. For the Lord said, "Where two or three are gathered together in my name, I am there in the midst." Even when we are eating our ordinary meals at home, we should be conscious of the presence of God. Thirdly, The breaking of bread demonstrates our own willingness to share our meals with those who don't have. We should be able to share with those who don't have. And that's what Acts chapter 2 verse 46, which we read in our scripture text, was about. It says, so continuing daily with one another in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart. That is singleness of heart, one heart. There was no malice in their heart. They were open, free. So you could eat. But how can somebody who has malice bring food to you to eat? His wickedness will be pursuing you, as it were. Acts chapter 20, verse 7. Acts 20, verse 7. This was when Peter got to Ephesus, I think, and he had a meal with them when Eutychus fell down and broke his neck, and they prayed him back to life. Now, on the first day of the week, that's a Sunday. The first day of the week is a Sunday, not Monday. We are the ones who chose the first day of the week to be Monday. In Bible times, it was Sunday. The last day of the week was Saturday. When the disciples came together to break bread, Paul, ready to depart the next day, spoke to them and continued his message until midnight. They gathered together to break bread, to share a meal. But also we know that there was also the part of communion in that. So in this instance, the breaking of bread was both a meal and the communion. So we are to be hospitable. We are to be able to share with one another. 1 Corinthians, I go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 11 again. These things will help us to understand some of the epistles. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, let me read from verse 17 to 22. Now, in giving these instructions, this Paul writes, in giving these instructions, I do not praise you, since you come together not for better, but for worse. Your coming together is not for better, it's for worse. Yet you are doing something wrong when you gather together. That's what he was saying here. For first of all, when you come together as a church, I hear that there are divisions among you, and in part I believe it. So, our coming together, there should not be divisions. But people are coming together and they are divided. He says, for there must also be factions among you, that those who are approved may be recognized among you. Church splits was never envisaged. Well, not envisaged, was never to be. We had to look for a way of resolving things. In verse 20 it says, therefore, when you come together in one place, it is not to eat the Lord's Supper. When you come together like that with all that divisions in your heart, is it the Lord's Supper you came to eat? It cannot be. You didn't come to do that. Look at verse 21. It says, for in eating, each one takes his own supper ahead of others, and one is hungry and another is drunk. You see that they were eating meals. It was not really the Lord's Supper per se. It was the meals, and then the Lord's Supper came after. Because if you read Matthew, the Bible says, after supper was ended, he took bread. So they ate something else before he took the bread and began to bless it and to speak of his broken body. He was saying to them, when you will gather together for your love feast, you don't even wait for one another. You start eating. In those days, it was like a potluck when they had a large enough space. This one will bring his own, that one will bring his own, everybody will bring their own, and then, you know, they mix it together. There were people who did not have, who were poor, who did not have. They would come and they would partake of the meal. But what was happening here was that they would come together with their own food, and before others even arrived, they finished the food. So when the poor come, the poor are hungry. You have nothing to eat. That's why I told them, don't you have food at home? Eat at home before coming here. And bring that your food to this place and feed the people who need it. Verse 22 says, what? Do you not have houses to eat and drink in? Or do you despise the church of God and shame those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you in this? I do not praise you. He was speaking about this coming together to share a meal. After the sharing of the meal, you can now break bread and enter into Lord's Supper. which was what the practice was in those days. They first of all dined together before they broke the bread. Like I said earlier, it's to bring soberness. So they don't just enjoy, eat, be full, and then think that, yes, that is what Christianity is about. It brought soberness to them. That this was how the Lord died for us. In eating the meal and bringing the poor, we remember how the Lord broke bread and fed 5,000, broke bread again and fed 4,000 men, not counting children and women. Likewise, we must bring of our substance and share with others. Fourthly, in the breaking of bread, we demonstrate our understanding and realization of the presence of the Lord in our midst. I said that earlier. Matthew 18, verse 20 says, Where two or three are gathered together in my name, I am there in the midst. It brings us to that sober reality that Christ is present with us. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31, the Bible says, therefore, whether you eat or drink, or whatever you do, do as to the glory of God. Whatever you are doing, remember that God is present. God is watching. So whether it is a meal or drinking, whatever it is you are doing, remember that God is watching. When you have enough, you know, it is sad. When you see, and I also get upset with my wife sometimes, when I see food wasting in the house. Because there are people who have not even eaten one day. And then they're throwing away food. It's annoying. It's grieving. We must remember the Lord is present when we're sharing those meals. In John chapter 6, 24 to 40 is a very lengthy passage. I'm not going to have time to read it. But this was when the people, the 5,000 who had eaten bread the previous day had pursued Jesus to some other place. And he said, why are you seeking me? Is it because of the bread you're looking for me or what? It's because you are not even interested in the fact that it was a miracle that fed you. You're only interested in the fact that you ate bread. He said, look, stop pursuing the things that perish. Focus more on eternal things. And then they went ahead over and I said, what is it that we must seek after? He said, believe in the person that God has sent. Put your trust in him and you will be saved. Food does not save you. Say, your fathers, they ate manna in the wilderness, they still died. And they say, hey, okay, since our father ate manna, give us bread to eat now. He said, I am the bread of life. Anyone who eats me will live. They said, look at this man, he's teaching us cannibalism. Of course, they didn't understand what he was saying. What he was saying was, if you are a part of me, if you are a partaker with me, in my life, in my ministry, which is basically the result of your believing in him, then you shall be saved. You are doing the will of God. You are doing the work of God. The work of God is to be a part of Christ, to be partner with him, to be of the same loaf, as it were. Finally, number five, in the breaking of bread, we demonstrate our renewal and reminder of the covenant the Lord has made on our behalf and to which we must be true. Remember how he paid the price for our death, for our sins, how he died for our sins. In 1 Corinthians 11, we've read that before earlier, verse 26 says, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he come. You are proclaiming that he died. So, the more we do it and remind ourselves that he died, the more we know. When somebody comes to say he didn't die, you tell him, keep quiet. If you believe that man who says he didn't die, then why are you eating communion? Of what value is it to you then? We don't want to engage in a ritual, like we said when we started church life. We don't want to engage in a ritual. We want to build relationship with God. So communion must not just be a ritual. It must be understood from the perspective of life with and in Christ.